I think, like a lot of people, I heard about it from my kids because, you know, they were the first ones to discover the book. You know, a lot of adults know it now, but at first it was this huge YA novel. And they were raving about it when they read it. And then I didn't read it for a little while. I heard they were making a movie about it. I mentioned, you know, I remember that you were talking about this movie, The Hunger Games, and they just sort of purged and exploded about it. It went on, and I had to actually stop them from telling me the whole book. But their enthusiasm was infectious. So I went upstairs. I started reading about 10 o'clock at night. I finished about 1 or 1:30 in the morning. And literally put the book down and said, you know, I have to make this movie. I just have to. I was that taken with it. I guess the way many people are taken with the novel. And I literally got on a plane Monday morning and flew to England to see Nina Jacobson, who was the producer. I mean, it was that impulsive. I had to make the movie. It's really a story of Katniss finding her own humanity. You know, she begins this story as someone who only wants to fight for her own survival. She's somebody who is a survivor. She sneaks through the fence in District 12. She poaches food for her family. She's fiercely protective of her sister. And she has the mentality of a hunter and a survivor. But what she learns through the course of the games is really her own humanity. What she learns through the course of the games is to care about people other than herself. And she finds something that's even more important than surviving, which is kind of being human. And so I think that that's really beautiful. Well, Susanna was really very special because we ended up actual collaborators. It wasn't just that she was involved, it's that we became a writing team. We were always talking, we had a good relationship, but then she came to LA and I got her thoughts on the script, and her thoughts were so good and it led to such an electric discussion between us. We began working together before we even realized it, and we were in this conference room, and I kind of looked at her and went, I mean, this feels so good. Why don't we just do this together? And she went, I'm in. And the next thing I knew, I had a writing partner again. The 12 various districts are being oppressed by the nation of Panem, by the capital, and understandably they rebel. And it's the suppression of that rebellion that ultimately led to the Hunger Games, because this is a means of control. This is a way that they keep the districts in line. And if they can control the districts and if they can keep them sort of under their boot heel, then they'll be able to derive the resources. You know, from District 12, it's coal. From District 11, it's agriculture. All the various districts supply something to the capital that the capital needs to solidify their power base. So it really is the degradation of the culture and what they've been through that led to this oppressive system. And it was the need to constantly keep the districts under control that led to the Hunger Games. Katniss Everdeen is an incredible character. She's a fierce survivor. She's incredibly independent. She's a hunter. She has these amazing survival skills that she's developed over time to protect and fend for her family. And she lives in District 12, which is one of the poorer districts. It's a mining district. It's essentially in Appalachia. So they live with a tremendous amount of deprivation. And she's always been fiercely keyed into her own survival and has these amazing skills which ultimately allow her to cope and deal with the game. She's an incredible archer. She's phenomenally athletic. She's lived in the woods by her own wits. So she's remarkably suited to survive in the games as they're configured in this story. The Reaping is this large sort of public spectacle that the Capitol creates every year. It's a public lottery, almost like a draft lottery, in order to select the tributes. It's something that everyone in the districts feels with an approaching sense of dread every year. They know when the Reaping is coming. They'll lose two of their own every year. Kids between the ages of 12 and 18 feel the specter of this thing approaching. And there's just sort of a looming sense of dread and fear that pervades the district leading up to the one moment when these names are chosen. It's their way of selecting the two tributes by lots. There's a mechanism within the game that allows someone to volunteer and to take the mantle of one of the people who's been selected, and so that they can assume that from them and volunteer to go in their stead. In the case of the careers, those are people who have been bred for this moment and are willing to volunteer because they want to go and fight. In the case of Katniss, it was a way of saving her little sister. And so she's placed in this terrible moment of having to actually volunteer to go in the games to save her little sister, and it's the first moment that you see kind of what Katniss is completely made of, that she would rather die than subject her little sister to this, which is really, really beautiful. It's also the seed, the first little shoot coming up of who she is. We see who she's going to become ultimately. When Katniss is first selected, she brings a lot with her, obviously. She's an amazing archer. She's incredibly athletic. She's lived in the woods. She's lived by her wits in the woods. She can climb a tree faster than anyone you know. She can hide in the woods. She has a highly developed acumen for being able to adapt to this environment and to hunt in this environment. So those are the raw skills that she brings in with her. She also brings, I think, a tremendous strength of character, which is that she has such an inner strength because it comes from a real place. At the end of the day, you know, Cato's strength or some of the career strength, it just comes from a kind of vainglorious place. It's almost like it comes from an attempt at achieving some kind of personal glory. Katniss is fighting for something larger. She's fighting for a little sister.
It was definitely a different casting process than I'd ever been through before.
You know, one of the great things about this is that it's a pretty big title in pop culture, and everybody has a very personal relationship to the book. All the fan base feels incredibly connected to it, and everybody has a very clear, very visceral idea of what Katniss Everdeen should be, or who PETA should be, or who Gale should be. So I'd never been through a process like this where so many people were invested with their own choices, but I thought that was wonderful because it just shows how connected to the material people are, how personal it is to them. They feel it's a book written for them, which is what, you know, Suzanne's monumental achievement is. And so, you know, both she and I embraced that. We thought that that was incredibly exciting. Someone like Jen comes by once a generation. I mean, this is an unbelievably rare thing. You know, this is Michael Jordan. This is Baryshnikov. This is somebody who comes with such unbelievable talent that it's almost stunning to witness. She's 20 years old. She carried this entire movie, but I just glimpsed this girl and I realized, like, I've just never seen this before. I've never seen this kind of raw talent. So she brings a lot of things that are really true to the character. Jen has a kind of natural athleticism. She has a ferocity. She has an incredible emotional power. But she's just so frickin' talented. I mean, there's nothing you can ask her to do that she can't do. And so, you know, it was thrilling, humbling, and exciting to work with her. And honest to God, if we didn't have her, I would not know how to do the movie. We'd seen a couple of PETAs come in and read, and we were, you know, they were perfectly great actors, but they were nowhere near the character. And I remember us looking at each other like, well, God, I hope this exists, right? I mean, we literally kind of, no one wanted to say it in the room, but Suzanne and I looked at each other like, hope this turns out okay, you know? And then Josh walked in and went, you know, I am this guy. And we went, what do you mean? He goes, well, he has this wonderful self-deprecating sense of humor. He's able to kind of disarm the world with a kind of charm, but he knows who he loves. He's loved this girl. He loves her so passionately and intensely. He always has. This is the one person he gave everything for. And he articulated everything that we felt about the character. And then I looked over at Suzanne like, man, I hope that this feels the way he just explained it. And then he read for us, and it was just like so unbelievably clear. It's funny with Woody. I thought he was great on the set. And then when I got in the editing room, I thought it was even way better than that. There was a reality and a truth and a kind of sadness and anger underneath what Woody was doing, that even though it's a comedic character and is very funny, and Woody's amazingly funny and has incredible comic chops, beneath it, there was a real smoldering subtext that he brought with him that I, honest to God, saw clearly when I saw him in the film, even more clearly than I saw it on the set. It sort of emerged and went, oh my God, that's really special what he's doing here. Elizabeth Banks was a huge fan of the series and wrote me a letter, as she did on Seabiscuit, going, I have to play this part. And I went, well, that makes a tremendous amount of sense. But of course, he went through a process like you do with anything, and we had a list and whatever. And I should have known, you know, A, Liz always gets what she wants, and B, she's usually right. So eventually, as I began to really think about the part, dive into the part, what the part required, that it has to be somebody who has these kind of comedic sensibilities, but at the same time isn't just interested in the comedy, that Liz really understood. She's a really smart girl, and Liz understood what the books meant. She understood who Effie was in the book. She didn't just understand Effie. And so she was able to see herself in context in a way that was incredibly important. We just had a blast together. I wanted to find this kind of rebellious rock and roll quality in the character. It also needed to be someone a generation older than Jen, you know, and Lenny, who's kind of so cool and so idiosyncratic and so much of an individual and so much of an iconoclast with his own sense of style and who he is. And I'd seen what he'd done in Precious, and I thought it was just remarkable that, oh, well, this guy's a great actor as well. And I thought, what an interesting way to go with the character, and he was terrific. When we began the process together, the first thing that was most important to me was that the capital evoke a sense of power and might and authority. And your first impulse reading Futurism is, okay, well, the gleaming spires up to the sky and all of that. But that isn't what you really want out of this story, because the thing that the cap, first of all, I wanted the capital to be a place that was set in the future but had a sense of its own past. And when you look at something like Blade Runner, you see the antecedent to that. You see what the sort of degraded culture was that led up to this moment. And in the capital, it was important to see this totalitarian state, what they'd built, and the feeling that it had always been there and had been there for a purpose. T-Bone wrote The Lullaby, which is the lullaby that Jen sings to Prim in the beginning and to Rue later on in the movie. Suzanne had written the lyrics in the book, and so this is something that's very iconic within the story already. T-Bone went away one night and called me the next morning and said, "You're just not going to believe this. You're not going to believe it." He was so thrilled. And then when I heard it, what was remarkable was it felt like it had always been there. It didn't feel like something that T-Bone had just written. It felt like something that just came out of Appalachia that mothers had been singing to their kids for generations. And that's also what's remarkable about T-Bone. He understands American music so well. He understands its history, its antecedents, where it comes from. And look at Oh Brother and the work that he did there. That it felt indigenous. And it was just such a remarkable achievement. And it's beautiful. I can't wait for people to hear it. In the case of Hunger Games, you're in Katniss's head. You're walking in her shoes. You know what she knows. You don't know more. You're on that experience with her 100% of the time. So that's the first thing one has to preserve. So, you know, I needed to give the audience that incredibly immediate sense that they were this girl, not that they were watching this girl. You know, and to that end, it requires an incredibly subjective cinematic style at the same time. I mean, I need to preserve that sense of first-person subjectivity. That doesn't mean shooting a POV. That means not knowing more than the character knows, having it be urgent and immediate and in her shoes and visceral and tightly with her the entire time, where you're experiencing it through her eyes.